We're glad you're here this morning. It's so good to see you this morning. It's a great, great crowd. Had a great service in the first service. We get to celebrate the Lord's Supper today. We get to celebrate the throne room of God. And we're welcome. We're glad you're here. If you're visiting with us, we want to make sure that at the end of this service, you come back to the table in the very back corner back there. And I'll be back there, and Amber will be back there to greet you. We have a gift we want to give you from the church. And so come back and see us. Now then, where is John Haynes? Stand up, John. I know you hate this. None of the guys are in here, right? This week, John had about four teenage boys. Actually, there's about five of them. And he spent the whole week teaching them how to build a rent. No, he's like 28 or he's like 50 or something. You know, Sherry's so old that that's her oldest, so she's old. But anyway, John built our ramp out here for us this week with the help of a bunch of teenagers. So y'all give John a hand. He hates this, absolutely hates it. But what was more impressive was that he spent all week teaching those guys how to cut boards and how to measure it and how to do all these other things, pouring into our students. So that's, we appreciate that, John. Appreciate all you do for our church. Also, if you are doing Man Church, if you're doing the Man Church curriculum, then this week should be the final week of what you've been studying. So we have prayer breakfast, men's breakfast next week. Chad and Avery are going to cook for us. But I have the new material right up here. You've got an email this morning, or you will get it this afternoon, with the new material on it. But if you want a hard copy of it, stop by up here, and we'll get you a copy as you leave this morning. Other than that, we are glad you're here. We're going to get into worship. I'm going to open us in prayer, and then we'll turn it over to our praise team. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for this day. Lord, thank you for revelation, for what you're teaching us about the future. God, I pray that you'll be with each person here this morning as we lock into what you're gonna, what we're gonna hear from Pastor David this morning. Lord, I pray that you'll be with us, Lord, that we never take for granted the things that you do for us and how your word reveals so much to us. God, I pray for our time together this morning that'll be honoring to you. I pray that all the words that come out this morning, the songs and through the message, will be for your glory. And I thank you for a church that is moving forward, and for what you're doing through our church with baptisms and with new members and growth, and just we give you all the glory for that. Lord, be with our time together now, and we pray all these things in your name. Amen.
Let's stand and worship. I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. In all my days, I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so. The goodness.
open in heaven. And the first voice which I had heard speaking to me like a trumpet said, come up here, and I will show you what must take place after this. At once I was in the Spirit, and behold, a throne stood in heaven with one seated on the throne. And he who sat there had the appearance of jasper and carnelian. And around the throne was a rainbow that had the appearance of an emerald. Around the throne were 24 thrones, and seated on the thrones were 24 elders clothed in white garments with golden crowns on their heads. And from the throne came flashes of lightning and rumblings and peals of thunder. And before the throne were burning seven torches of fire, which are the seven spirits of God. And before the throne there was, as it were, a sea of glass like crystal. And around the throne, on each side of the throne, are four living creatures full of eyes in front and behind. The first living creature like a lion, a second living creature like an ox, the third living creature like the face of a man, and the fourth living creature like an eagle in flight. And the four living creatures, each of them with six wings, are full of eyes all around and within. And day and night, they never cease to say, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. And then in Revelation chapter 5, verses 1 through 12. Then I saw in the right hand of him who was seated on the throne a scroll written within and on the back, sealed with seven seals. And I saw a mighty angel proclaiming with a loud voice, who is worthy to open the scroll and break its seals? And no one in heaven or on earth or under the earth was able to open the scroll or look into it. And I began to weep loudly because no one was found worthy to open the scroll or look into it. And one of the elders said to me, weep no more. Behold, the Lamb of the tribe of Judah, the root of David, has conquered so that he can open the scroll and its seven seals. And between the throne and the four living creatures and among the elders, I saw a lamb standing as though it had been slain, with seven horns and with seven eyes, which are the spirits of the God of God sent out into all the earth. And he went and he took the scroll from the right hand of him who was seated on the throne. And when he had taken the scroll, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, each holding a harp and golden bowls of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. And they sang a new song, saying, worthy are you to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slain, and by your blood you ransomed people for God from every tribe and language and people and nation, and you have made them a kingdom and priests to our God, and they shall reign on the earth. And then I looked, and I heard around the throne the living creatures and the elders the voice of many angels, numbering myriads of myriads and thousands of thousands, saying with a loud voice, worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing. Let's pray together. God, thank you for that glimpse into the throne room of heaven. God, today we've been singing that you are the one who is worthy. So God, as we open up your word, as we dive into this passage of scripture, and as we kind of put ourselves there where John was, God, will you speak to our hearts today in a very powerful and mighty way. God, you are worthy. And Lord, we're mindful that today we get to come to your table. And so Lord, just in these next few moments, will you begin to prepare our hearts? God, will you examine us? Will you search us? Will you try us? God, we want to come to your table with a pure heart and clean hands. And so, God, I need you. I want you. We desire, Lord, we're begging you to speak to us clearly today. Lord, we love you. We praise you. You are the one who is worthy. And all God's people said, amen, amen. You can have a seat. Wow. Powerful, powerful passage of Scripture. Amen? These verses are so powerful, and what we're going to do today is we're going to kind of walk through chapters 4 and 5 of the book of Revelation. My goal here today is really simple. I just want to get out of the way and let you see Jesus. Amen? That's what I want to do. My prayer this week has been that you not necessarily that you're going to learn something so much new today, but you would experience the living God in all His majesty and all His power and all His all-inspiring demeanor. Again, the book of Revelation, as we've talked about before, is a book that needs to be experienced. So that's what we're going to do today. So I know if you've looked in your handout, there's not many notes. There's not any fill in the blank. Some of you are kind of wigging out because what am I supposed to do? Listen, I'm encouraging you to open up your Bible. And I'm encouraging you to open up your Bible to Revelation 4 and 5 and just hang out there. We're going to leave scriptures on the screen during this time today. And we just want you to take notes as the Lord leads you. I want you to underline things that the Lord leads you to underline. I'm going to help you with some of the things we need to underline, some of the key verses in this passage of Scripture. But we're going to talk about the throne. We're going to talk about the scroll. And we're going to talk about the Lamb today. And I would encourage you, again, just to open up your Bibles. We're going to start in chapter 4, verse 1. Here we go. Ready? After this. After what? Well, after the first three chapters of the book of Revelation, right after what John has experienced in Revelation chapter 1, when he sees the living Lord resurrected, Jesus glorified, and Jesus standing kind of among the lampstands, among the churches. Then in chapters 2 and 3, last week we talked about this, how Jesus kind of evaluated and judged some of the churches there. After this, he says, after this I looked, and behold, a door standing open in heaven. Now, let me just kind of pause right here for that in that scripture, because I just don't want to stop there. I don't want to kind of just read over that. I want you to just park your thoughts right there. There's a door that goes into heaven that's standing open here. In other words, it's kind of a gateway. It's kind of a passageway from one dimension to another, from one reality that's opened up to another one. And someone has opened this doorway, right? Someone opened this doorway for not only just John to step through it, but for us. Amen? We get to step through it today. And so someone's opened this up. And if you look at Revelation chapter 1, it reminds us this is not just for John. Revelation 1 reminds us that this revelation came from God to Jesus, to the angel. Angel delivered it to John, and John forwarded it on to us. Amen? So this is a door for us. This is a doorway. I want to invite you this morning to walk into this doorway, into the throne room of heaven. Let's see what's on the other side, because there's some things that Christ Jesus wants us to see. The invitation this morning is for us not, I don't want us just to be here and just, amen, amen, amen. I want us to go on a journey. We're going on a field trip today. Amen? We're walking into the throne room of heaven. We're going to cross this threshold between flesh and blood and the world of the Spirit. And we're going to see a reality of more of what we can, more than we can even taste or see or touch or feel or hear. We're going to have to use spiritual eyes this morning. We're going to have to use spiritual ears this morning, because that's what we're going to need to kind of experience what we're going to experience in Revelation today. How many of you all know, come on, how many of you know in your Christian life that what you've learned in your Christian life up to this point in your life and all the things that are going around you in the natural world are not always most real, right? Come on, how many of y'all know that to be true? So there's some other things going on, right? There's some spiritual battles going on. And that's what the book of Revelation is really pointing us to. And so we're going to see what's really going on here, right? Because when we look at the world around us, we kind of think, well, this government's in charge, and this leader's in charge, and this guy is sitting on the throne. And I want you to know that the book of Revelation tells us that there's another reality. That there's another throne, and there's another seated on that throne. And so, church, let's walk through this threshold, through this open door together today. Amen? Can y'all tell I'm excited? Okay, I just want to make sure you're there. Okay, so the rest of that verse 1 says, "And the first voice which I heard speaking to me like a trumpet said, come up here." That's a trumpet, right? "Come up here, I will show you what must take place after this." It says in verse 2, at once I was in the Spirit. That means that all of a sudden John was kind of in this different dimension, not this physical world. And behold, a throne. Now, when you're doing Bible study, let me just kind of give you a little hint here. When you're doing a Bible study and you see a word that's repeated time after time after time after time, pay attention to that word. And you'll see the word throne is repeated several times in this passage of Scripture. John is trying to lay out a principle for us. John is trying to let us know that we need to be focused on this throne. So let's pay attention this morning to this throne. What is he trying to draw our attention to? He says, "Behold, a throne stood in heaven, and one seated on the throne, and he who sat there had the appearance." Now let me pause there and say, John is ready for this? John is ready to describe God Almighty. How many of y'all want that job? I don't know that there's enough words in the English language to do that. And this is what John is trying to do. He's trying to describe the indescribable. And so he uses phrases like "he had the appearance of" or "he looked like" because he's trying to describe what is indescribable. God is not jasper and he's not carnelian. He had the appearance of jasper and carnelian. And also notice that he doesn't use any kind of human terms to describe God. Later on, we'll hear in chapter 5 where he describes the right hand of God. That's really the only form that we get that's kind of human. But there's no description of his face. There's no description of his form at all. All we get is that he had the appearance of jasper and carnelian. And around the throne was a rainbow that had the appearance of an emerald. Then it says, around the throne. So you start to pick up here what John is kind of pointing out to us. He wants us to focus on this throne. So around the throne, he starts to describe what's around the throne were 24 thrones. And seated on the thrones were 24 elders clothed in white garments with golden crowns on their heads. Now what a sight this was. Now here's the question. Who are these elders, right? Who are these people? Who are these guys? What's their function? What do they do? And the answer, really, to be honest with you, is a lot like most of what is in Revelation. We don't fully know, okay? And we could make some speculated guesses, and anyone who tells you, "I know who those people are," here's where they're probably going a little bit too far in their interpretation of this. We can make some thoughtful conclusions, but what we can say certainly is that the word "elder" there, translated into English, means old. How many of y'all fit that bill? Anybody want to raise their hand? Okay. So they're ancient. They've been around for a while. And so these elders are in God's presence. And we can assume that they have a measure of authority because they're sitting on thrones. Not the throne, but they're sitting on thrones surrounding the throne. And so they're around this throne. Now so you're starting to pick up kind of this image of this throne that's in the center. John's trying to lay down for us that the throne is the center of the story in Revelation chapter 4. And you'll notice that everything in this chapter is described by its relationship with the throne. The throne is in the center. What's around it, what's before it, what's beside it. John's describing all this, but the focus is the throne. Look at verse 5. From the throne, imagine this, came flashes of lightning and peals of thunder. I mean, just imagine what that must have sounded like, what that must have looked like. Before the throne were burning 7 torches of fire, which are the 7 spirits of God. 7 here, folks, being the number of perfect completion, meaning there's nothing lacking here. This is the fullness of God, and this is referring to the Holy Spirit. Verse 6, look at what verse 6 says. And before the throne, there was, as it were, a sea of glass, like crystal. And around the throne, on each side of the throne, are 4 living creatures full of eyes in front and behind. So John has walked through this window, this doorway into heaven, and he's in the throne room, church, listen, he's in the throne room of heaven. Told you we were going on a field trip today. Are y'all with me? We're in the throne room of heaven. We're in the command center of the universe. John is seeing this, but he's kind of seeing this from somewhat of a distance. And as we dig deeper into the book of Revelation, we'll see that the sea typically has kind of a connotation throughout the scripture. It has a connotation of kind of chaos or the unknown, right? I mean, if you remember, when the disciples were out on the Sea of Galilee in their boat and there was a storm and they were scared because the unknown, right? It was a stormy, they didn't know what was underneath the sea, right? And Jesus comes and he says, "Peace be still," and the storm calms. And then they're afraid of Jesus. Why? Well, because he's a guy who can calm the seas and the wind. There's something about water, scripturally, that kind of represents the unknown. And it makes sense because, think about it, back in those days, they didn't have things like submarines. They didn't have scuba gear. They didn't go down into the depths of the abyss and kind of see what was underneath the water. So it was a mystery to them. It was scary. It was chaotic. It was down in the abyss. And so the water represents chaos. And as we get deeper into Revelation, we're going to see even that the beast himself that we talk about in Revelation comes out of the water. Interesting. You remember in Genesis chapter 1, in the creation story, there's water, and it's all sort of chaotic, and then God comes along and creates order out of chaos, right? So it's interesting to think about here in the throne room of heaven, what John sees is that we don't have the chaos of water, but in the presence of the Almighty God, the water is what? Still. Like a sea of glass, like crystal. Can I just say, church, it's something to be in the presence of God. When you're in the presence of God, everything kind of just pays attention, right? And so here John has this sea of glass, like crystal. And it says, around the throne, on each side of the throne, are four living creatures full of eyes in front and behind. In other words, these are strange-looking creatures. Hard to imagine what they might have looked like. Look at verse 7. The first living creature was like a lion. The second living creature like an ox. The third living creature had a face of a man. And the fourth living creature like an eagle in flight. A lot of speculation about what those four kind of creatures were representing. A lot of people have connected those four creatures to the four gospels, the four characteristics of Jesus and his ministry. That's a beautiful connection, but look at verse 8. And the four living creatures, each of them with six wings, are full of eyes all around and within. And day and night they never cease to say, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come." Now I want you to picture this for a minute. It's interesting here. John uses the word holy three times. Holy, holy, holy. All holiness. That's the idea. When you see something repeated three times, it's like the complete number. It's as holy as you could possibly get. Holy, holy, holy. Interestingly, in a future chapter in the book of Revelations, we have a number that represents man. And that number is 666. Not 777. But 666. And you'll start to see here what John is trying to get at with holy, holy, holy. This is as holy as he can be. This, he is holy. And maybe this is the reason that these creatures are full of eyes. Maybe within and without, because they're looking at something that you have to be filled with eyes to even comprehend. That our two eyes won't do it. Our two eyes that we see with couldn't possibly comprehend this. We couldn't take in the glory of God, the holiness, the majesty, the splendor of the Almighty God would require a vision that we do not have. And here they are standing in the throne room of heaven. And again, they're just saying, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come." So I want you to understand, church, listen to me, lean into this. John is drawing our attention to the throne. He 14 times in this passage of Scripture, he refers to the throne. Everything is situated around the throne. Why? Well, because the Lord wants to give John and us a picture of the future. Right? What we're going to see, especially as we dive into to chapters 6, 7, and 8 next week, and come back next week, you're not going to want to miss that. We're going to see some things that are a little bit frightening. We're going to see some things that are, quite frankly, pretty scary. We're going to see some things that, but really, a lot of Christians kind of stay away from the book of Revelations because of what's in chapters 6, 7, and 8. We're going to be seeing a lot of judgment. We're going to see a lot of things happening. And so there's an order to this here, right? There's an order to why we're in chapters 4 and 5 first before we get to those scary things. John wants us to pay attention to the throne. God says, look, I want you to see this first. I want you to peek into the throne room of heaven, and I want you to see who's in charge. But not just a throne. Church, listen. This is not just any throne. This is a throne standing in heaven in a realm above the natural realm. This is a throne above all thrones. This is a throne that's not toppled. This is a throne that's not an empty throne. This is not a throne with somebody who's on it, who's asleep, who is out to lunch, who has forgotten what his job was. No, he who is seated on the throne is ruling and reigning right now. And John, before we look into the future, before we look at some of the things that are a little bit scary, he wants us to see all of that through the lens of the throne. It's all about the throne. Now, maybe some of you are going, okay, Pastor, that's great. Revelation's wonderful, fantastic. Let's move on. But here's the application for you. Because remember, Revelation chapter 1 talks about how this is a book that needs to be obeyed. Not blessed are those who just hear it. Blessed are those who obey it. So how do we do that? What's our application? What does this mean? How are we to apply this right now? How are we to obey this right now? Well, church, when you look at your future, what do you see? What do you think about when you look into the future? What do you spend your time, church, looking at? Can I tell you, I've observed this, that a lot of God's people are troubled because they spend more time watching the news than they think they spend looking at the throne. I got a little quiet when I said that because you know it's real. You know it's true. Some of those people are you. You're watching Fox News. You're watching CNN. You're clued into the news all the time. News, news, news. And what you're doing in process of that, you're kind of paying a close attention to what's going on in the world. And in your mind's eyes, you're focused on everything else. You're focused on the economy. You're focused on the election. You're focused on talk radio. You're bothered by this. You're bothered by that. You're frustrated, wondering why things aren't changing, wondering why the world seems to be going to hell in a handbasket. And let me just kind of tell you, church, if you'll take your eyes off of that for just a little bit and kind of fix your eyes and set your eyes on the throne, I think things will begin to happen differently. I think you begin to have a little bit more peace. I think you would begin to have a little bit more confidence. I think you would have a little bit more joy. I think you would have a little bit more calmness in your anxiety and your depression. We would be reminded that there's a throne, and the one who is seated on the throne is the one that I belong to. It's the one that I serve. It's the one that's the throne above all thrones. And so Revelation chapter 4 answers the question, who's in charge? Who's reigning? Who's ruling? Who's on the throne? Think about it. Think about it. John, think about this. John is writing this book. He's writing this book to a church that's under persecution. He's writing this to Christians who oftentimes, like I said earlier, would have to sit in front of a Roman tribunal. And they would say, are you a Christian? You need to tell us Caesar is Lord. And I want you to understand, these Christians, they had read Revelation chapter 4. They had read John's letter to them. They knew Caesar wasn't Lord. They knew that Jesus was Lord. Caesar may have a throne. He may sit on a throne made of gold or wood or something, but there is another throne, and it's higher than your throne. And I'm not going to serve. Caesar's not my Lord. Jesus is Lord. And we need to be reminded of that. I need to be reminded of that. We need to be reminded and keep our focus on what is really going on. So John here is showing us what's really happening, what's going on. And then he continues in John chapter 5. Don't miss this. Look at John chapter 5, verse 1. Then, come on. Was it not enough that he got to peek into the throne room of heaven? Well, was it not enough that he got to go to the command center of the whole universe and see God on the throne? I mean, that's incredible. Then he says, then, it gets better, then I saw in the right hand of him who was seated on the throne a scroll written and on the back, written within and with on the back and sealed with seven seals. seals. Now I just want you to, this is a unique picture. So there's this throne with this thing that looks like jasper and carnelian, who peals of thunder and lightning's going off, and it's just an awe-inspiring sight. And then John kind of captures a glimpse of, it's almost like a hand holding a scroll. So the anticipation is building here. Now, it's hard. This is a different focus. Chapter 5 is a different focus. The focus in chapter 4 was the throne. In chapter 5, the focus changes to this scroll. And it might be a little hard for us to kind of wrap our minds around a seven-sealed scroll, what it would look like. Because many of you, you know, none of you students at school, you know, your teachers go, here's your scroll for the day. Nobody does that. You don't go to your job and your boss gives you a scroll of things to do. No, we don't deal with scrolls anymore. So what does a seven-sealed scroll look like? I found one that I think possibly would probably resemble or represent what John is trying to describe. I put a picture of it here. You can see it's a scroll that's wrapped and then sealed with seven different seals. And so you can't just go and just unseal number four before you do 1, 2, and 3, right? So there's an order to this, and this is kind of what a depiction of a seven-sealed scroll would look like. Here's the image. And so the seven seals are not all, again, sealing at once, but as they're broken, they begin to be read. And we're going to talk about that in chapter 6, 7, and 8. And so, but you have to start at number 1 and work your way down to number 7. And so as John is looking, he can see in the right hand of him who sits on the throne a scroll with this writing on it. And it's important that you, folks, listen, you need to understand what this scroll is about. You've got to understand this. What is the scroll of Revelation chapter 5? Folks, it is the scroll of the unfolding of the plan of God, the future plan of God, the coming kingdom. Fully consummated kingdom of God. That's what it is. You remember in the Lord's Prayer, we Jesus taught us to pray. He says, pray that your kingdom come, that will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Jesus Christ, when he came on this earth, he came preaching and teaching and proclaiming the gospel of the what? The kingdom. And so the good news of the kingdom, that's what he was about. And so it was a coming kingdom. Now we know that Jesus is a king over a kingdom, but that kingdom has not been fully consummated yet. You and I live in between two ages here. We're living in what is called the already and not yet. Now understand this, meaning that Jesus, yes, he's already king, but he's not fully consummated the kingdom yet, because even though redemption has happened, Jesus died on the cross, redeemed us of our sins, it's not yet fully realized because you and I are not walking around in resurrected, glorified bodies yet. Right? And so, in other words, there's a new age coming. There's a new heaven. There's a new earth that's coming that we read about later in Revelation. And the whole world's going to be made new, and God's going to dwell with his people. And so as we dig deeper into the book of Revelation, you and I will get there. We're not living in that time yet, but we're going to get there. We're living in the in-between time. And John gets a glimpse of this. John gets a glimpse of this ceremony. John gets a glimpse of this inauguration of the new coming of the new age. And we're going to see this coming, the full consummation of the kingdom of God, where Jesus takes control of the universe, of all of it. Look at verse 2. And I saw, let me before I get there. And when I was in high school, I ran track. And the last event in a track meet is always the mile relay, where everybody runs a quarter mile, and then, you know, you have to pass a baton, right? And I was in high school, and I was a senior in high school. I was the anchor leg for my track team on the mile relay. And it was such an anticipation, because you knew at some point you were going to grab that baton, right? And you were going to take off. And I loved it, because when the third leg, and his name was Chucky Rhines. Chucky, if you're listening, man, hello, man. It's good to see you, buddy. And he was my high school buddy. And he would run the third leg. And when he was a fast runner, and he would always kind of be in the lead most of the time. And so I was so It was so much anticipation building up in me. I couldn't wait. I just, give me the baton already. I want to take off. I want to run, right? And that's kind of what we're dealing with here. We're dealing with this anticipation. John sees the throne of God. He sees the scroll kind of being out there going, here it is. And look at what it says in verse 2. And I saw a mighty angel proclaiming with a loud voice, "Who is worthy? Who is worthy to open the scroll and break its seals?" That's really the question of Revelation chapter 5. Who is worthy? Verse 3 says, "And no one in heaven or on earth or under the earth was able to open the scroll or to look into it. And I began to weep loudly because no one was found worthy to open the scroll or to look into it." So this angel is crying, and he's saying, he first looks at heaven. He looks at all those creatures and all those elders. Is there anybody worthy? Anybody? You back there in the back, anybody? Nope. Nobody. Then he looks on earth. Is there any man, woman, boy, or child that's worthy to open this scroll? Anybody? Nope. Then he looks under the earth. He looks at all the people who have died. He looked at Abraham and Moses and David and Joshua and Nehemiah. Hey, is there anybody down there? Is anybody worthy? Nope. Nobody's worthy. No one's found worthy. And the Bible says that John began to weep loudly because no one was found. Now, here's the question that blew my mind this week. Why does John cry? This is the Apostle John. This is the disciple that walked with Jesus for 3 years. Does he not know about Jesus? Did you not live with Jesus for three? Did you not see Jesus walk on the water? Did you not see him raise people from the dead? Did you not see him do all those miracles? Do you not understand who Jesus is? Why is he crying? And I think really the best explanation of this maybe for me was that maybe John is just so presently caught up in that moment, in this throne room of heaven, that he is not absolutely aware of anything else anywhere ever. He's not aware of any of his past experiences. He doesn't remember anything that's gone on. He's just there in the moment, and he sees God with this scroll going, it's ready. But nobody's worthy. And he knows that's the unveiling of God's plan. And he's crying out loud because, listen, church. If this scroll is not opened, then the coming of the kingdom of God will never happen. And maybe you're thinking, well, why should I care about that? Well, because if the scroll doesn't get open, then this world as it stands right now in June of 2024 is as good as it gets. War will be eternal. Brokenness and abuse will never, ever end. Wicked people will always take advantage of the weak and the vulnerable. I mean, think about it. Cancer will always have a place in this world. Old age will always eventually overtake us, and death will swallow us all. Y'all encouraged right now? This is as good as it gets. If someone can't break those seals and open the scroll. Because when that scroll gets open, church, when that scroll is open, those seals are broken, a new age begins. There's a new heaven and a new earth, and now certain to come with this moment that John is kind of witnessing this, the scroll has to be open, and no one's found worthy. No one's found worthy. Look at verse 5. And one of the elders, now think about this. John's here in the throne room of heaven, the throne of God, jasper, carnelian, lightning bolts, everything. And there's hand with the scroll. I don't know what that looks like. I can just kind of picture it in my mind. The angels announced that nobody's worthy. Nobody's worthy. And an elder that's in one of the thrones kind of sees John and sees his tears. And he says this, and one of the elders said to me, "Weep no more." Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has conquered so that he can open the scroll and its seven seals. I think that's three of the most beautiful words in all of the New Testament. Weep no more. Weep no more. Can I tell you, church, I don't know how you came in here today. I don't know what situation is going on in your life. I don't know what circumstance, what downtrodden kind of event has happened in your life. But listen, you can confidently know that God can look at you and say, weep no more. Somebody needed to hear that today. Jesus is the victor. He is the conqueror. He can open the scroll, and he can open the seven seals. Look at verse 6. And between the throne and the four living creatures and among the elders, I saw a lamb standing, as though it had been slain, with seven horns and with seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent out into all the earth. Now, I love this. The elder looks at John and says, weep no more. A Lion of Judah, the Root of David, is conquered. And John turns around. What's he see? Not a roar. I mean, not a clawed, you know, not a roaring. No, not a lion. No, he sees a lamb. In other words, the lion doesn't come with his claws and his roar and with his teeth. The lamb shows up, and he shows up so that he can be conquered, so that he can pay the ransom to buy a people back for God. He wins. The lamb wins at the expense of his own life. And I love verse 7. I think it's interesting that verse 7 is 7. It's the number of completion. But verse 7 says, and he, talking about the lamb, and he went and took the scroll from the right hand of him who was seated on the throne. Do you know what we're seeing here, church? Do you know what we're getting a glimpse of here? Do you know what's going on here? We're getting to see one of the most significant moments in all of creative history. It's when the Father looks at the Son and says, it's time. It's time. Here's the scroll. You're the only one worthy. This is what we're seeing in verse 7. We're going to bring in this new age. Now, this has not happened yet, but John gets a glimpse of this for us to share with us, for us to have hope, for us to have faith in knowing that's going to happen. Look at what it says in verse 8. And when he had taken the scroll, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, each holding a harp and golden bowls full of incense. I want you to underline golden bowls full of incense. We're going to talk about that next week. What that is. What's it about? It says, which are the prayers of the saints. Verse 9. And they sang a new song, saying, worthy are you to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slain, and by your blood you ransomed people for God from every tribe and language and people and nation. Why are they singing a new song? Because the old one didn't do it justice. They're singing a new song. Something is new. This is new. This has never happened before. This is a new song, and I think the question that maybe all of us have here is, why sing a new song? Well, they need a new song because something amazing that's never happened before is about to happen. Something new, something crazy. Look at the rest of it. Look at verse 10. And you have made them a kingdom and priests to our God, and they shall reign on the earth. Then I looked, as if that's not enough. Then I looked and I heard... Imagine this. I heard around the throne and the living creatures and the elders the voice of many angels numbering myriads. I don't even know what a myriad is, but it's a lot. It's myriads of myriads and thousands of thousands saying with a loud voice, worthy, worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might. Somebody clap, and glory and honor and blessing. Amen. Did y'all hear what I just said? This is amazing. This is incredible. This is what John gets to see. And here's the question. The question in Revelation 4 was, who reigns? The question in Revelation 5 is, who is worthy? So I'm going to ask the band to come on out here. And here we're going to end. We're going to be done with this. But listen, I think that's the question all of us are asking today. We're entering into an election season. Hear me. Lean into this. No, this is not where Pastor Dave's going to get political. We're entering into an election season, and the next year, I think the question for many of us is going to be, who is worthy? Who's got the know-how? Who's got the qualifications? Who's got the leadership attributes to take us where our country needs to go? And depending on who you ask, you're going to get different answers to that question. I don't know about you, but it drives me nuts talking politics. It makes me want to pull my hair out because everybody's asking who's worthy, who's it need to be, and you just can't come up with a good answer. A good answer doesn't exist because, church, we've just heard in Revelations, no one's ever going to be found worthy because there's only one who's worthy, and he's not running for president. There's only one. And this year, the only one who's worthy, for every year, for years past, present, and future, there's only one that was honoring, is able to receive the glory and the power and the might and the wealth and honor and dominion. That's the Lamb who was slain. He's the one before whom every knee will bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus is Lord to the glory of God the Father. So I just, today, I want us to end in worship. We're going to come to the Lord's table. I've asked Rourke and the band to just sing this song, Is He Worthy? It's a song that demands a response. So the words are going to be on screen. I want everybody to stand. I just want everybody to stand right now. We're going to stand in honor of the one who is worthy. We're just going to sing this song. And when he asked the question, is he worthy, is he worthy? We need to scream out and sing out of top of our lungs, he is, he is. There's going to be some other questions in this song. It walks you through what we just read in Revelation chapter 4 and chapter 5. Let's worship together.
Slay, is he worthy?
as a Father truly loves us.
He does.
Does the Spirit move among us?
He does.
And does Jesus, our Messiah, hold forever those He loves?
He does.
Does our God intend to dwell again with us? He does.
Worthy. Amen. He alone is worthy. You're not going to find anybody else in heaven, on earth, under the earth who's worthy, but Jesus is. And so today I thought it would be appropriate for us to just come to His table. He's worthy, church, because of what he did for us on Calvary. He's worthy because he was the perfect, sinless Lamb of God. He's worthy because he took all of our sins, past, present, and future, and he went to the cross. He paid the penalty for our sin, the penalty that we should have paid. He went to the cross that we should have had to bear. He bore that cross, and he went to that cross for us. And his body was beaten. Isaiah said his body didn't even look like a man. His blood ran out of his body until there was no more blood left in his body. He did that for me. He did that for you. So today we get to come to the Lord's table and we get to remind ourselves. That song we just sang just said it's important to remind ourselves of these things. Today is the Lord's Supper. Not only is that song going to remind us, but what we're going to do here at the Lord's table is going to remind us of what Jesus has done for us. So let me just kind of give you some instructions. There's three tables. You can come to any table. I'm going to pray in just a minute. When I say amen, I want everybody just to rise up and come and get a cup, get some bread, take it back to your seats. We'll take the communion together. If you're not a member of our church, but you're a believer in Jesus Christ, we invite you to come to the table. This is an open communion. We're glad that you're here. We've got visitors here from Montana. We've got visitors here from Jonesboro, Arkansas. And we've got visitors here all the way from California. And we've got some visitors here from Denver, Colorado. You're welcome to join us at the Lord's table. Yeah, it's awesome. It's awesome. Parents, if you have small children, you want to use this as maybe a teachable moment to kind of teach your kids what the cup and the bread is all about. I encourage you to do that. It's a great teachable moment. Maybe even if you're a Christian here today and you've had a struggled week, a struggled month, maybe you've been kind of far away from the Lord. Maybe you want to sit this one out. That's okay. There's no judging here. The Bible says we need to examine ourselves and where we stand with the Lord before we come to the Lord's table. So I encourage you to do that. There's not going to be anybody judging anybody here today. But if you've prayed and you've felt like that you're ready to kind of come to the Lord's table, I encourage you to do that with joy today. If you're gluten-free, we have some gluten-free bread right here. So come to this middle table. We'll kind of take care of everybody here at the Neoma Baptist Church. Rourke and the band is just going to play some music as we come in just a minute. And I know that this is something I don't want to just end the service with. This is something we just don't just tag to a part of the service. This is a sacred, holy moment. We've already gone into the throne room of heaven today. Now we get to go to his table. We get to remind ourselves of what Jesus Christ did for us on the cross. Let's stand. Let's pray together. What a sacred moment this is, God, that we get to come right here, right now, at Neoma Baptist Church, June of 2024, we get to come to the Lord's table. We get to take the bread and the cup, these elements that remind us of Jesus, what you did for us on the cross of Calvary. God, it reminds us of the fact that you, and you alone, are worthy to open the seal and open the scroll. That you and you alone are worthy of our praise and our worship. And our only response today is just to worship you. So God, I pray that as we sing and as we come and grab these elements, we'll do that in a moment, in a demeanor, in a posture of just prayer and meditation on you and what you've done for us. God, we thank you for your love, an amazing, incredible love you showed for us on the cross. And God, today we come to remind ourselves of that. Lord, we love you. Bless our time together, and I pray this in your name. Amen. Come. Come as we sing.
I once was lost.
night in the upper room, you know, as sitting here thinking and meditating and praying and thinking about what we shared from Revelation 4 and 5, Jesus knew all of that. And it wasn't time to kind of unveil all that yet. And he was in the upper room with his disciples. His 3-year stint of ministry on this earth was coming to an end. He knew that. The Bible says that he took bread and he broke it and he gave thanks. That's what we want to do right now. Let's give thanks. God, we are grateful for your goodness. We've sang about your goodness today, your faithfulness. We're grateful for that. We're grateful for all the things that you've given us. We're grateful for our families, our church family, our salvation. The fact that we live in a country that we're free to worship as we want to worship. We love you. We give you the thanks and the gratefulness that only you deserve. Amen. The Bible said he broke the bread and he gave it. And he said, this is my body. Do this in remembrance for me. Bible says that he took the cup in the same manner, gave it to the disciples and said, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Jesus was saying, this is something new. This is something new. It's a new covenant in my blood. Take it and drink it as often as you do it in remembrance of me. He then told his disciples that as often as you eat the bread, drink the cup, you're proclaiming the Lord's death till he comes. My prayer is that today you'll see things a little differently. My prayer is that today you see things through the lens of a throne. Through a lens of not a lion with claws, but through the lamb that was slain. So here's what we want to do. We're just going to continue this invitation. Here's what I think is probably happening in this room right now. Maybe there's somebody here. Maybe somebody brought you. Maybe you just kind of wandered in. Maybe you've been coming for several weeks, but you're lost without Jesus Christ. There's never been a moment in your life where you've accepted Jesus as Lord and Savior of your life. If that's you, I'm so glad that you're here. And I would want nothing more. Our church would want nothing more than for you to get that right with the Lord. And maybe during this invitation, some of our staff will be up here at the altar. You can just come and say, hey, I just need to be saved today. And we'll pray with you. We'll rejoice with you. We'll welcome you into our family. We'll disciple you. That's a decision you have to make. So if that's you, today could be a day of salvation for you. Today could be a day where from this point forward, you could take the Lord's Supper afresh and anew in a very new light. You could think about Revelation chapter 4 and chapter 5 in a new light because you have that hope because you're a child of God. You serve the one who's worthy. I think another thing that's happening right now in this room is there's Christians all over the room who maybe just from what we've preached today, maybe just from being able to take the Lord's Supper, maybe you've just got this gratitude overwhelming in your heart. And maybe the only thing you can do is maybe just come to this altar and just say, thank you, Jesus. Thank you for who you are. Maybe you're a Christian here and you're struggling in your faith and you're struggling with something at work, with your family, at home. You're struggling with something health-wise that you just need God to kind of intervene. And I'd encourage you to come and do something a little different. Get out of your comfort zone. Get out of where you're sitting and come into this altar and pray. God hears your prayers. He's worthy to bring your prayers too. So it's all over this building today. I encourage you to do what God's leading you to do. If you want to pray with somebody, we've got some prayer warriors up here. We'll be glad to pray with you. Okay? Let's all stand. Let's pray together. God, right now is a time of decision. You've laid out in the book of Revelation this future. You've given us a glimpse into the throne room of heaven and what's going to take place. in days to come. And Lord, I just want us to make sure that we're ready as Christians. And God, I pray for those maybe who are here that are lost without you, that God, today would be a day of salvation. Today, they would have the courage to go and speak with somebody, to say, hey, I need to be saved. Maybe there's somebody here that needs to take that next step in their spiritual journey. Maybe somebody needs to follow the Lord in believers' baptisms. Next Sunday, we're going to have 5 baptisms next Sunday. Praise the Lord. But God, maybe there's somebody here today, we need to add 6 or 7 or 8 or 9 or 10 more to that. So God, will you work and move in your people right here, right now? Maybe there's just Christians in the room that just want to come to this altar and just give you praise and give you gratitude for what you've done. So God, will you work in and through us right now as we sing? And I pray this in your name. Amen. Come. Come as we sing.
Hi, friends. Amber here with some exciting news. We are launching into the next phase of our Kids Initiative Going Further program. This program has been in process for 7 years. And for those of you that don't know, we're adding on a whole new children's and preschool wing to our church. It is finally here. It's time. So we want you guys to be informed and involved. And just make sure that you go to our website and check out all of the updates, all of the information, ways that you can help. All of the things will be on our website. I am so excited to see what God is going to do through our children here at LBC.